فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأصلي وأسلم على من أرسله الله رحمة للعالمين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. This is our second day inshallah ta'ala in the program which I said we will call it ضبط العلم, precision in knowledge. We've taken a portion of the kitab ta'zim al-ilm and we finished yesterday walillahi alhamdu wal minnah, praises to Allah. We finished al-qawa'id al-arba'ah and today inshallah ta'ala we're going to do a portion of this kitab ta'zim al-ilm and after that bi'idhnillahi al-kareem we're going to do all of nukhbatul fikr inshallah ta'ala today. Sam.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قال الشيخ صالح بن عبد الله بن محمد العصيمي وفقه الله تعالى في كتابه تعظيم العلم المعقد الثاني إخلاص النية فيه. إخلاص النية فيه إن إخلاص الأعمال أساس قبولها وسلم وصولها. قال تعالى وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين حنفاء. وقال البخاري في الجامع المسند الصحيح ومسلم في المسند الصحيح واللفظ للبخاري حدثنا عبد الله بن مسلمة قال أخبرنا مالك عن يحيى بن سعيد عن محمد بن إبراهيم عن علقمة عن عمر رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الأعمال بالنية ولكل امرئ ما نوى وما سبق من سبق ولا وصل من وصل من السلف الصالحين إلا بالإخلاص لله رب العالمين.
الأوثر رحمه الله إن اسمه معقد. In this chapter, which is the second, he talks about al-ikhlas sunniyati fi, sincerity. So last lesson, we spoke about cleansing and cleaning the heart. This is the place you want to put knowledge in, which is your heart. Then what you need to do is you need to clean the heart. Get rid of everything. And the thing that you need to clean it from it is what? Najasatu. الشبهات والشهوات, doubts and desires. Now the author starts with the first thing which you need to place in your heart now. It's a clean heart, it's a pure heart, it's a cleansed heart. Let the first thing you place in your heart be al-ikhlas of sincerity. And ikhlas is what he mentioned in the previous chapter with this. And he said it in one line of poetry, إخلاصنا لله صف القلب من إرادة سواه فاحذر يا فطن. إخلاصنا لله صف القلب من إرادة سواه فاحذر يا فطن. You clean it. إخلاصنا means what? إخلاصنا لله صف القلب. Clean the heart, which you already did. And then what you place in your heart is what? Intending it for Allah alone. A clean heart with a good intention is what sincerity is. So you want to, we said it yesterday, you want to drink a cup, you pour out everything that's in there, you clean that cup. Once it's clean, then you pour something in there. Then and only then would the taste be correct. You'll be tasting the right flavor, and that's what the heart is. So what did we say haqiqatul ikhlas means? What's the reality of al-ikhlas? Number one is tasfiyatul qalb, cleansing the heart. And we said, what do you have to clean from it? Ash-shahwat and shubuhat. Both of those are what you have to clean from it. And then the second thing is, connecting this heart to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now it is what you have to place in your heart. Let nothing else preoccupy your heart. Don't do it so you want to gain praise from the people or you want to gain a worldly gain. And I said all of that is summarized in that line of poetry which I mentioned. The author there, rahimahullah, he says, إِنَّ إِخْلَاصَ الْأَعْمَالِ أَسَاسُ قَبُولِهَا وَسُلَّمُ وُصُولِهَا. Ikhlas is the foundation, it's the asas. Asas means the foundation. Of any action being accepted from a person, sincerity is the foundation for it. In other words, Allah does not accept an action that is not done with sincerity. وَسُلَّمُ وُصُولِهَا, and it is the ladder, it's not just a foundation, but it's also the ladder to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reaching and attaining that particular action and really getting the reward for it, the ladder for it, and the foundation for it is sincerity. And then the author brings قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, the statement of Allah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا, Allah says, I have not commanded them. This ma is ma'un nafiyya, negation. Allah is saying, I did not command them. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, except to worship Allah. مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, in a state of sincerity. Here this word, al-deen here, means al-ibadah, as the Mufassirin mentioned. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, أي al-ibadah, the religion. حنفاء, we spoke about it yesterday. حنفاء means الميل عن الشرك. It is, حنفاء means is to divert from shirk, and it's to divert towards tawheed. Then the author rahimahullah brought Al-Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih, and he named it. He says, وقال البخاري, Al-Imam al-Bukhari said, في الجامع المسند الصحيح. That's the name of the book Al-Imam al-Bukhari wrote. It is called Al-Jami' al-Musnad al-Sahih. Wa Muslim, and also Al-Imam al-Muslim. Fi al-Musnad al-Sahih, in his authentic book al-Sahih. Wa lafzu lil-Bukhari, and the wording of this hadith, this particular wording, is the wording of who? It's the wording of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. And then he says, Haddathana Abdullah ibn Maslama. Abdullah ibn Maslama here is Al-Qa'nabi. Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi is Shaykh al-Imam al-Bukhari, is the teacher of Imam al-Bukhari, and he's also the teacher of who? Al-Imam Muslim. Qala, he said, Akhbarana, and Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi is from the Ruwat who narrated the Muwatta' from Malik, rahimahullah. Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi, he narrated from Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he narrated from him, his Muwatta, but it's not very famous as much as the narration of Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi, is the riwayah of Muwatta Imam Malik that became very famous, and it really became very famous because the Maghariba, the people from Maghrib, Mauritania, Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, that's called Maghrib. We call them North Africa, right? Yeah. They've accepted the riwayah of Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi. And of course, they say the reason is because that was the Ard al-Akhir, that was the final edited version of Al-Imam Malik's Muwatta. Not to mention Al-Imam ibn Abdul Barr in his kitab Al-Tamheed, and also his other kitab Al-Istidkar. Both of them are sharh of Muwatta Imam Malik, but each one is relying on the marfu'at and one is dealing with the mawqufat. And we're going to study what that means inshallah today. So Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi, Bukhari saying, Haddathana Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi, which is his sheikh. Qala akhbarana Malik. Malik here means who? Malik ibn Anas, al-Imam Malik, the great Imam. An Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Ansari. An Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Taymi. An Alqamah ibn Waqas al-Laythi. An Umar radiallahu anhu. Ibn Hajar brings that there is a khilaf whether Alqamah is a sahabi or not. It's a khilaf. He actually says that he could be a sahabi. Ikhtulifa is differed upon whether he's a sahabi. So if he's a sahabi, then the hadith has too many, he has two sahabas, Alqama and Umar. And this narration of Umar, he narrated it on the pulpit, and it's ajib, no one else narrated it from him, even though he narrated it on the pulpit except Alqama. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, that the messenger said, Al-a'malu bin niyyati wa likulli imri'in ma nawa, that actions are what is intended by it. Ibn al-Daqiq al-Eid, in the sharh of this hadith, he mentions that al-a'malu bin niyyat, al-a'malu bin niyya, which is the wording here, that the author chose, and وَلِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, are not the same meaning. Some people think that it's a repetition of what was already mentioned. Al-a'malu bin niyya, actions are what is intended by it, وَلِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, and everybody is rewarded in accordance to their intention. That's what the second part means. So it is not a repetition. So every single action that you come with is what you intended from it. And then the reward is going to be based upon that intention. So me and you can take a flight today. We could travel to Saudi Arabia, to Mecca. I might be going there for a wedding and I want to get married to a woman. And you might be going there for Umrah or Talab al-Ilm or to seek knowledge. We're both in the same flight. We both booked it from the same agency. We both are sitting shoulder to shoulder. We both land at the same time. We both reside in the same hotel. Everything from the apparent, we're the same. But one person's reward is high above and another person's reward is not there. What is it that changed the two? An-niyyah, intention. Two people are praying at the front line, one is rewarded and the other one is not rewarded. What is it that's making them two different? The intention. So seeking knowledge, this is what a person needs to observe. It's not to observe your outer appearance, and it is not to observe your actions merely. Is what is needed from you is to observe your intention and what's in. That's when the author then says, وَمَا سَبَقَ مَنْ سَبَقَ وَلَا وَصَلَ مَنْ وَصَلَ. He did not go forward, the one who went forward. سَبَقَ means preceded. وَلَا وَصَلَ مَنْ وَصَلَ. And the one who reached did not reach. مِنَ السَّلَفِ الصَّالِحِينَ, from the pious predecessors. إِلَّا بِالْإِخْلَاصِ, except with sincerity. Those you're seeing today, it's narrated that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu did not pass the Ummah بِكَثْرَةِ صَلَاةٍ وَصِيَامٍ وَزَكَاةٍ وَصَوْمٍ. No, they say that. Abu Bakr did not pass the people because of extra fasting he came with, extra zakat that he did, extra umrah that he did. Some of the scholars say that. But he passed them because of his heart. He passed them because of his heart. ولذلك the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say? What did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say? He said, لا تصبوا أصحابي, do not insult my companions. Why? فلو أنفق أحدهم, فلو أنفق أحدكم, if one of you was to give مثل أحد ذهبا, the mountain of أحد of gold in quantity, you came and you brought forward صدقة. That sadaqah that you gave is the mountain of Uhud. Have you guys seen how big the mountain of Uhud is? You brought forward the mountain of Uhud of gold. This will be nothing close to a hand, two palms together of barley or wheat in which a companion brought forward. Now look at the quantity and the amount. Who's more? The one that brought the mountain of Uhud. The Sahabas only brought what? Just the one handful, or bring your hair. Are you with me, brothers? How did they pass? When they're giving it, they're giving it from what? From a heart different from these people, sah? So this is where it is that everybody passes each other. We, on the other hand, we judge the people based on what? We judge the people based on the action. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, يُؤْتَى بِالرَّجُلِ السَّمِينِ الْبَدِينِ, the day of judgment, a man who is big, chubby, is going to be brought and he's going to be placed on the scale. فَلَا يَزِنُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ جَنَاحَ بَعُوضَةً, he will not weigh the wing of a mosquito. Nothing. Are you with me, brothers? This man's big, he's heavy, look how weight, look how many meat is on him. مَعَذَلِكَ, he weighs nothing. The reason why he doesn't weigh anything is because it's the heart. And we mentioned the hadith of Abu Huraira, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ أَمْوَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَعَمَالِكُمْ. Allah doesn't look at your forms and Allah does not look at your wealth and how much money you have. What Allah looks at, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is looks at the person's heart and their action. Then the author said,
قال أبو بكر المروذي سمعت رجلا يقول لأبي عبد الله عن أحمد بن حنبل وذكر له الصدق والإخلاص فقال أبو عبد الله بهذا ارتفع القوم.
The author then brought the statement of Abu Bakr al-Marrudi. His name is Ahmed. His name is Abu Bakr al-Marrudi. His name is Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn al-Hajjaj. Ahmed ibn Muhammad al-Hajjaj al-Marrudi. He took from Imam Ahmad directly, and he's from the elite students of Imam Ahmad. And from him took Abu Bakr al-Khalal. Abu Bakr al-Khalal took from him directly. He died the year 275. And he wrote a very powerful book, which I advise each and every one of you, if you can read the Arabic language, to read. He wrote a book called Kitab al-Wara. Kitab al-Wara. It's an amazing book that talks about this concept of al-Wara. The author then says, Sheikh Saleh ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi, حفظه الله سمعت قال المر he says قال أبو بكر المرودي سمعت رجلا I heard a man يقول لأبي عبد الله so أبو بكر المرودي saying I heard a man say to أبي عبد الله who is he referring to يعني أحمد بن حنبل now if you guys have the copy of the book did the sheikh write أحمد ابن between a did he write an alif on the ابن he did write He did. Is that what he says for everybody's copy? Yeah? He wrote the Alif al-Wasli. Huh? Yours doesn't say it. Yeah? Yours doesn't say it. Okay. This is an issue now we need to talk about. This issue of Ahmed ibn al-Alif writing it. Many people always have ishkal of it. The original copy of the book, the author, this is the one Akhuna Sheikh Yasin has, is the one that the author wrote. And he wrote Alif there. The ulama, they differ amongst themselves in the writing of the Alif. There's an Alfiyah written by Ibn Mu'ti. And it was an Alfiyah before who? Ibn Malik. Ibn Malik wrote 1,000 lines in Nahu and Sarf, right? And before him came a man by the name of Ibn Mu'ti. He wrote also an Alfiyah. Are you with me? Are you with me, brothers? And Ibn Malik praised him, but he said, my book is better. He says, وَهُوَ بِسَبْقٍ حَائِزٌ تَفْضِيلًا مُسْتَوْجِبٌ ثَنَائِيَ الْجَمِيلًا وَاللَّهَ أَرْجُو بِهِبَاتٍ وَافِرَهُ لِي وَلَهُ فِي دَرَجَاتِ الْآخِرَةِ Ibn Malik says, he's only better than me because he preceded me. He's only before me. And this is a virtue itself. A sabq is a virtue. And so I asked for Allah and him. But it's funny because Ibn Jalaluddin al-Suyuti came and he wrote 1,000 lines in Nahu. He also called it al-ashbah wal-nadair. He called it in grammar. He has one in usul al-fiqh and he has one in Nahu. He called it al-ashbah wal-nadair. He says mine was better than Ibn Malik's. Sah? He's only better than me because he preceded me. That's what he said. Suyuti said it. Ala kulli hal, Ibn Mu'ti, he mentions in a line of his Alfiyah, he says, وَأَلِفُ بْنٍ وَابْنَةٍ وَصْفًا حُذِفْ كَحَذْفِ تَنْوِينٍ كَزَيْدِ بْنِ خَلَفْ And that is, if a alif, I want, oh, this is, today I'm very slow the way I'm talking, right? So you guys can write, note it down, nothing passes you. If, pay attention, I'm going to ask you guys later. The alif al-wasli, which the author wrote now here, if it falls between two names, two alam, two wasf, two descriptions, which are two names, he says, وَأَلِفْ ابْنٍ وَابْنَةٍ, the alif of ibn and ibnatin, a woman, wasfan hudif, it's removed because it's a description between two names. It's like كَحَذْفِ تَنْوِينٍ, it's like the removing of a tanween between two names. Like you can't say Muslimun ibn Hajjaj, you can't say that. You can't put tanween on Muslim if you're going to bring his second name. Are you with me, brothers? One more time. You are not allowed to write the alif if you're bringing two names. Two names, in between two names, you can't bring an alif. Just like you're not allowed to bring tanween between two names. Are you with me, brothers? But Shaykh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi is taking an opinion that says, with the condition. Ibn Mu'ti doesn't believe that condition. But Shaykh Salih al-Usaymi believes that condition, which is with the condition that the first and the second name are his name and his father's name. And Hanbal is not Imam Ahmed's father's name. His father's name is Muhammad. So his name is Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal. Are you with me? So for him, the condition is absent, which is the two names has to be his name and his father's name. His name and his father's name. And since Imam Ahmed, Hanbal is not his father's name. Hanbal is whose name? His grandfather's name. So the alif is brought and it's placed there. Are you with me, brothers? Underline that point. That's a benefit that you can use when you're writing. A lot of people fall short in this issue of when it comes to. So he says, does everybody understand that? قال أبو بكر أبو بكر said المرودي سمعت رجلا I heard a man يقول لأبي عبد الله saying to أبي عبد الله يعني أحمد بن حنبل. So the copies that don't have the alif, they're taking the opinion of what? Those who are saying as long as it's between two names, regardless of whether it's his name or whether it's his granddad's name, is it between two names? Is it a description? Both of these names are describing him. So they say, Hudif is removed. That's the call of Ibn Mu'ti, right? So both copies are like that. وَذَكَرَ لَهُ الصِّدْقَ وَالْإِخْلَاصِ. With him, pay attention. And Imam Ahmed, in his gathering, a man said to him, Abu Bakr al-Marrudi was sitting there and he heard a man come to Imam Ahmed and he told him about sincerity. And he told him about Sidq. Now Sidq and Ikhlas, there are a difference between the two. Al-Ikhlas means sincerity in what you do to Allah, for Allah. This is Ikhlas. Ikhlas means what? When you're doing something for Allah, you do it for Him alone. So you don't associate anyone with this action for Allah. Sidq, on the other hand, is that this action that you're doing, you do not associate that action with another action. Does that make sense? You're sincere to the action. And the other one is you're sincere for the one you're doing the action for. Ikhlas means sincerity for the one you're doing the action for. That's Ikhlas. And Sidq means that you're truthful to the action, that you do this action. For example, when you're seeking knowledge, how do you seek knowledge? I have nothing else in my heart. I don't want anything. I'm not doing it for any other motive to share with knowledge. I'm doing it knowledge for knowledge alone. Does that make sense? And the other one, Ikhlas, which is that I'm doing this for Allah alone. So those two were mentioned to Imam Ahmed. فقال أبو عبد الله أحمد said, رحمه الله بهذا ارتفع القوم. Because of that, they were raised. القوم means what? الرعيل الأول. The early generation, they were raised because of that.
قال وفقه الله تعالى وإنما ينال المرء العلم على قدر إخلاصه والإخلاص في العلم يقول يقوم على أربعة أصول بها تتحقق نية العلم للمتعلم بها تتحقق نية العلم للمتعلم إذا قصدها. الأول رفع الجهل عن نفسه بتعريفها ما عليها من العبوديات وإيقافها على مقاصد الأمر والنهي. الثاني رفع الجهل عن الخلق بتعليمهم وإرشادهم لما فيه صلاح دنياهم وآخرتهم. الثالث إحياء العلم وحفظه من الضياع. الرابع العمل بالعلم، فالعلم شجرة والعمل ثمرة وإنما يراد العلم للعمل.
The author رحمه الله, he says وإنما ينال العلم, وإنما ينال المرء العلم. The person will attain knowledge ala qadri ikhlasihi, in accordance to his sincerity. You will gain knowledge in accordance to what? In accordance to your sincerity and how sincere you are. If a person is not sincere, then they don't attain any form of knowledge. وَلِذَلِكَ It was narrated from Abdullah ibn Abbas. What did he say? He said this statement, which is, a person attains knowledge and gains knowledge in accordance to his intention. A person attains and he gains knowledge in accordance to his intentions. When you come with sincerity and you purify your heart, knowledge starts to go in. It enters your heart.